إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. مرحبا بكم جميعا، أهلا وسهلا. We thank Allah Azza wa Jal for allowing us to come together once again for His sake, in hopes that we can remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for some time out of our day, in hopes that we can increase our belief, our iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and get closer to Him, in hopes that we distance and further ourselves away from the path of Iblis, the path that leads to the hellfire. And indeed, with Allah Azza wa Jal is the success. Today, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, the topic is dealing with some of the praiseworthy characteristics of the believers. Characteristics that are befitting for us to adorn ourselves with, in order that we be from the believers whom Allah Azza wa Jal has described as being successful. When Allah Azza wa Jal mentions قَدَ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, that indeed the believers are successful. And then afterwards, Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentions some praiseworthy characteristics of these believers whom He has described as being successful. And these characteristics, after the tawfiq from Allah, is the cause of the success. When we look at the beginning of the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentions three categories of people: the believers, the disbelievers, and the hypocrites. Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentions Alif Lam Mim, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبل وبالآخرة هم يوقنون أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he mentions Alif Lam Mim. This is the book which there is no doubt within it. Guidance for those who have a taqwa, piety. Allah Azza wa Jalla starts off by magnifying his book, the Quran. That which is his speech, which is not created. This is a book in which there is no doubt of it, no ambiguities, no deviance, guidance for the muttaqeen, those who have the taqwa of Allah. Then Allah goes on to mention those who believe in the unseen. This is from greatest of the characteristics of the believers. Those who believe in the unseen. And what else? They establish the prayer. And from that which we have provided them with, they spend. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla describes the believers with praiseworthy characteristics, those who believe in the unseen, those who establish the prayer, and those who spend from that which Allah has provided them with. Allah says, and those who believe in that which has been revealed to you, meaning you, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that which has been revealed before you, O Muhammad, meaning to the previous prophets and messengers, and they have certainty regarding the hereafter. Those are the ones who are upon guidance from their Lord. And those are the ones who are successful. In these first verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah Azza wa Jalla praises the believers with a great praise, mentioning at the beginning of the praiseworthy characteristics, believing in the unseen. It is a must, barakallahu fikum, that as believers we believe and that which is in the Quran, and we believe in that which is in the Sunnah, from that which has authentically been reported on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with firm belief. Whether it is from the matters that we have seen physically with our eyes, or experienced, or it is from the matters of the unseen. Cannot waver in our faith. Our faith must be strong. Believing in that which Allah Azza wa Jalla requires us to believe. Believing in that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam requires us to believe in. There is no honor greater than the honor that Allah Azza wa Jalla gives to the believers. And there is no bliss greater than the bliss that Allah Azza wa Jalla He gives to the believers. Believing in the unseen, that we believe with our hearts. We believe with our tongues, and we believe with our body parts, with our actions. Believing in Allah, His angels, His books, His messengers, the last day, and the divine decree, the good of it and the bad of it. Believing with our hearts, having the firm conviction, with no doubt whatsoever, as Allah described the true believers, they do not have any doubt. As Allah mentioned, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. Indeed, the believers are only those who believe in Allah and in His Messenger. And then they do not have any doubt. And they strive with their wealth. And they strive with their lives in the path of Allah. Those are the ones who are the truth. We believe with our tongues, professing our iman in the unseen, professing our belief in Allah, professing our belief in the angels and the books, the messengers, the last day and the divine decree. We do not hide our faith. And the greatest statement of belief in the unseen is the statement of Tawheed, La ilaha illallah. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, Al-Iman bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba, or sittuna shu'ba. فأعلاها أو أفضلها قول لا إله إلا الله. That faith is 70 something or 60 something branches. The highest part of faith, or the best part of the faith, is the statement لا إله إلا الله. None has the right to be worshipped except for Allah. The statement, La ilaha illallah, entails belief in the unseen and professing one's belief in the unseen. Because a part of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is believing in that which Allah has informed us of in the Quran. Is a part of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and confirming that which Allah azza wa jal has mentioned, meaning in our belief is firmly established, believe it, no doubts. And believing with our actions is that we strive with our actions, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hoping for that reward on the day of judgment. This is a way that we believe in the unseen with our actions. As is mentioned in the verse that was previously quoted, وَجَاهَدُ بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And they strive with their wealth and their lives in the path of Allah. الملائكة هم الصادقون. Those are the ones who are truthful, meaning truthful in their faith. Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentions وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. Allah Azza wa Jal, He's describing the hearts of the believers, how it trembles in fear. Meaning when Allah is mentioned, and when they hear the verses of Allah recited upon them, it increases them in faith. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. And they put their trust upon their Lord. Allah is speaking about the believers. But then look, Allah says, أَلَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِمَّا رَزَقُنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Those who establish the prayer from that which we give them, they spend. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. Those are the true believers. The shahid or the point here is that Allah, as the Wajah mentions, actions along with them having faith in their hearts. So belief in the unseen, there's going to be actions that come from this belief or as a result of this belief. A person, he believes, he will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be held account for one's deeds, one's statement, one's creed. So the person strives to make sure that his creed is sound and that he doesn't have the creed of the polytheists and he doesn't have the creed of the people of innovation. He makes sure that his creed is the creed of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A person, he strives to make sure that his statements are words that are pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he keeps away from saying that which opposes the religion of Allah out of fear of Allah's punishment. So see, the person preserving his tongue coming as a result of believing in the unseen, believing in the hereafter. Likewise, in one's actions, one makes sure that he's behaving in the manner that is pleasing to Allah, hoping for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Staying away from that which can bring about Allah's anger and punishment in the hellfire. So it's important, or from the most important characteristics of the believers, is them believing and the unseen. And a part of belief in the unseen, first and foremost, believing in Allah, believing in the angels, and believing in the books and the messengers and the last day and the divine decree, and acting accordingly to one's belief. From the praiseworthy characteristics of the believers, that which Allah has described them with and praised them for, is the establishment of the prayer. As we have seen in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah says, أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Those those who believe in the unseen and they establish the prayer. Allah, he mentions and describing the believers. Alif Lam Mim. تلك آيات الكتاب الحكيم هدى ورحمة للمحسنين الذين يقيمون الصلاة. Alif Lam Mim. These are the verses of the wise book. Guidance and a mercy for the good doers, those who establish the prayer. Those who establish the prayer, barakallahu fiq, wa fiqum jami'an, Allah Azza wa Jal has described them as being good doers. And the greatest good that a person can do after having belief in Allah, belief in the Messenger, and other than that from the pillars of faith, the greatest act that a person can do is the establishment of the prayer. We find throughout the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal, after mentioning the believers or the characteristic of belief, you find Allah mentioning those who establish the prayer. As Allah mentions, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةِ لَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. And indeed those who believe and do righteous deeds and establish the prayer and they give the zakat, for them is their reward with their Lord. There's no fear upon them, nor will they grieve. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned, indeed those who believe, and they do righteous deeds. And then after mentioning, generally, they do righteous deeds, Allah mentions the best of the righteous deeds. And they establish the prayer. And they give the zakat. For them is their reward with their Lord. And look what comes as a result of believing, and establishing the prayer, and the payment of the zakat. There's no fear upon them. After having their reward with their Lord, there's no fear upon them, nor will they grieve. Even in the statement of Allah, قَدَ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Successful indeed are the believers, those who have khushur, humility in their prayers. The salah, ikhwan wa akhawat, is the greatest of the acts of ibadah. Do not be negligent regarding the prayer. For being negligent regarding one's prayer, it can lead a person to fall into indecency and evil. As Allah Azza wa Jalla, he mentioned, اُتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ. And recite that which has been revealed to you from the book and establish the prayer. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَلِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Indeed, the prayer prevents a person from that which is indecent and from the evil. So when a person establishes the prayer, this is from the greatest of the means that will prevent the individual from indulging in indecency and indulging in evil. But when an individual abandons the prayer, was negligent regarding the prayer, the person is removing the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and opening up the door to be led astray by the whispers of the shaitan. So it is a must that we establish the prayer. And establishing the prayer is establishing it in the manner that was taught by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. praying at the proper time, fulfilling the conditions of prayer, fulfilling the pillars of the prayer, the obligations of the prayer, and increasing in the beauty of the prayer by doing that which is recommended to do with the prayer. The prayer, Ikhwan wa Akhawat, is our direct connection with our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not cut off that connection. Do not cut off your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by being negligent in your prayers. Enough for us as a warning is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, بين الرجل والشرك والكفر ترك الصلاة. That between the man and polytheism and disbelief is the abandonment of the prayer. Or the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الأهل الذي بيننا وبينهم الصلاة فمن تركها فقد كفر. That the covenant between us and them, that which is between us and them, is the prayer. Therefore, whoever abandons it has disbelief. Stern warning from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to those who abandon the salah. The abandonment of the prayer is the cause for the person leaving Islam. And this is whether the person abandons the prayer, denying its obligation, and the scholars are in agreement that this person is a disbeliever, or the person abandons all of the prayers out of negligence and laziness. And this is a position of a group from amongst the scholars of Ahl al-Sunnah wa al-Jama'ah. And other than them, they say that if the person acknowledges the obligation of the prayer, but yet he abandons it, that this is a major sin from the major sins, and the person is in grave danger. In any event, the establishment of the prayer is one of the greatest of the characteristics of the believers. And when we look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we find that the sunnah establishes that the believer should be consistent upon praying 40 raka'ah in the day. And these 40 raka'ah they are the 17 raka'ah from the obligatory prayers. And then you have the 12 raka'ah from the recommended prayers that are connected to the obligatory prayers. 2 raka'ah before Fajr, 4 raka'ah before Zuhr, 2 raka'ah after Zuhr, 2 raka'ah after Maghrib, and 2 raka'ah after Isha. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the great reward for the one who prays these 12 extra raka'ah, and the day that Allah Azza wa Jalla will build for this person a house in the paradise. And Shaykh Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentioned a tremendous benefit connected to this narration. And that is that every day that a person prays these 12 extra raka'ah, be built for this individual in the power ranks. So if a person, as an example, plays these 12 extra rak'ah 7 days straight, then this will lead to the person having 7 homes in the paradise. So every day that a person plays these 12 extra rak'ah, a person will have a house built for him or her in the paradise. So here we have 29 rak'ah. 17 for the obligatory prayers, 2 rak'ah for Fajr, 4 for Dhuhr, 4 for Asr, 3 for Maghrib, and 4 for Isha. Then the 12 supererogatory rak'ah that are connected to these obligatory prayers, 2 before Fajr, 4 before Dhuhr, 2 after Dhuhr, 2 after Maghrib, and 2 after Isha. And then lastly, we have the 11 raka'ah of Qiyamul Layl. As Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not pray more than 11 raka'ah in Ramadan or outside of Ramadan. So here we have 40 raka'ah that we are encouraged to make from them, that which is obligatory, the 17, and then that which is highly recommended. And making these prayers, this strengthens the individual's faith, their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it causes the individual to be under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is upon us that we strive to adorn ourselves with this praiseworthy characteristic, the establishment of the prayer. First and foremost, establishing the obligatory prayers, and then secondly, establishing those recommended prayers. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, regarding the night prayer, أفضل الصلاة بعد المغتوبة قيام الليل, that the best prayer after the obligatory prayer is the standing of that night prayer. And look what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about the 2 raka'ah that are recommended to pray before Salat al-Fajr. Raka'at al-Fajr khayru min al-dunya wa ma fiha, that the 2 recommended supererogatory raka'ah before Fajr, these 2 raka'ah are better than the dunya and whatever is within it. All of this is a great encouragement for us to establish the prayer and increase in our ibadah, getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of our prayer. So indeed, this is a praiseworthy characteristic that we should adorn ourselves with. Also, we should be mindful not to allow the shaitan to steal from our prayer. As Aisha radiallahu anha, she mentioned, سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الالتفات في الصلاة فقاله اختلاس يختلسه الشيطان من صلاة العبد. Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about a person turning in his prayer or her prayer. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, it is thievery. The stealing of the shaitan steals from the prayer of the slave. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, إن أسوأ الناس سرقة الذي يسرق صلاته. قالوا يا رسول الله وكيف يسرقها؟ قال لا يتم ركوعها ولا سجودها.
They will see plan, steal the prayer, and don't you steal from the prayer. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, that indeed the worst of the people is stealer, and the root of stealers is salat, the form of prayer. The companion of his servants said, Allah, how does one steal from it? He said that the person when he prays, he doesn't complete what's done, nor does he complete what's been instructed.
So it is a nice ikhwan wa akhawat that we pray in the manner that has been taught to us by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not be negligent when it comes to our prayers. Whether it is while we're in the prayer or outside of the prayer when it comes to making the prayer, we should not be negligent. The prayer is the coolness of the eyes of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet used to say, Ya Bilal, a'ihlib as-salah. O Bilal, bring ease to us by way of the prayer. So in trying to be like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should strive to reach the point where the prayer is the coolness of our eyes. From the characteristics of the believers, from the praiseworthy characteristics that are mentioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, praising the one who adorns oneself with it, is the preservation of one's private parts. Protecting one's private parts from the acts of illegal sexual intercourse. Protecting one's private parts from the indecent acts of homosexuality and lesbianism. After Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions that successful indeed are the believers, from the characteristics that Allah He mentioned, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ, and those who preserve their private parts. إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ وما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين. Except for with their lawful spouses, or that which the right hand possessed. For in that case, they indeed are not blameworthy. فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون. So whoever desires other than that, or beyond that, those are the ones who have transgressed the boundaries. My noble brothers and sisters in Islam, zina is a horrible crime. Homosexuality is a horrible crime. Lesbianism is a horrible, indecent crime. For this goes against the characteristics of those who are successful. And that in itself should be a deterrent. One should not embark upon any type of actions or behaviors or statements that will prevent one from being successful. If a person, as an example, in his worldly affairs, has a business that is thriving, a business that is successful.
That individual who cares about his business or her business is going to do that which it takes to preserve the business. So therefore, they're careful who they hire to work for them. They're careful where they make their investments, and other than that, that we find the business people doing to protect and preserve their businesses so that they are successful and remain successful. The success of the believer, which is the religious success, is more important than the worldly success. So just as you will not jeopardize your worldly success and just throw it away, even more so, one should not jeopardize one's religious success. And one of the ways to jeopardize one's religious success is by way of committing zina, or not preserving one's private parts from indulging in indecent actions. There are a lot of harms that come as a result of zina to the individual himself or herself, to the families, to the communities, to the society as a whole. And hopefully, by the permission of Allah, the talk can be done dealing with this topic specifically. But due to the time, we mentioned some of the harms that come from the committing of zina. One of the greatest harms that comes as a result of committing zina is that it affects a person's faith. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, la yazni al-zani hina yazni wa huwa mu'min. The person who is committing zina is not a believer at the time that the person is committing zina. This statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a great deterrent from this action of zina. That the Prophet here negates faith from the person who is committing zina. And the negation of faith here, as believed and held by Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and this is the correct understanding of these, of this narration and those like it, it is a negation of the completeness of Iman, and not the negation of Iman in its totality. But in any event, being that Iman is negated from the one who performed this act, this is an indication of how severe this act is in evil. Zina is not from the characteristics of the righteous believers. Allah Azza wa Jalla He mentions, الزاني لا ينكح إلا زانية أو مشركة والزانية لا ينكحها إلا زان أو مشرك وحرم ذلك على المؤمنين. And the zani, the man who commits illegal sexual intercourse, he does not marry one except for a zaniya or a mushrika. وَالْذَانِيَةِ
لا ينكحها إلا ذات. And the female who commits illegal sexual intercourse, no one marries her except for one who is a male who commits illegal sexual intercourse or a polytheist. So here Allah Azza wa Jal is stating that a female who commits illegal sexual intercourse nobody marries her except for a man who is similar to her. Even though he knows it's wrong, he does it anyway, so in his case, it's zina. Or a mushrik, a person who doesn't believe that it's wrong to be with this type of woman. So in this case, he disbelieves in Allah. Likewise, the man who commits illegal sexual intercourse, no one marries him except for a woman who is like him. She knows it's wrong to marry him, but she does it anyway. This marriage is not valid. So she's a zaniya. Or she's a mushrika because she doesn't believe that it is prohibited to marry this type of man. Look what Allah says at the end. وَحُرِّمَ ذَٰلِكَ عَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. That is prohibited for the believers. Meaning this is not from the type of people that the believer should marry. And this again, barakallahu fikum, is an indication of how evil zina is, that Allah Azza wa Jal prohibits the believer from marrying the zaniya or the zan. So if the people are indulged in illegal sexual intercourse, Allah Azza wa Jal has made it haram for people to marry them. A man came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rather a youth, and said, Ya Rasulullah, إِذَّنْ لِي بِالزِّنَا. O Messenger of Allah, allow me to commit zina. فَأَقْبَلَ الْقَوْمَ عَلَيْهِ فَزَجَرُوهُ وَقَالُوا مَهَ مَهَ. So the people, they turned to him and they reprimanded him and they said to him, مَهَ مَهَ, stop, refrain from this. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, اُدْنُوهَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to come close, so he came close to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he sat. And then the Prophet said to him, أَتُحِبُّهُ لِأُمِّكَ. Do you love that somebody commits zina with your mother? قَالَ لَا. He said, no. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَاللَّهِ جَعَلَنِي اللَّهُ فِدَاكَ. قَالَ وَلَا النَّاسُ يُحِبُّونَهُ لِأُمَّهَاتِهِمْ. So he said, no, I do not love this from my mother, and may Allah Azza wa Jal make me your ransom for you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, likewise, the people do not love this for their mothers. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَفَتُحِبُّهُ لِإِبْنَتِكَ. Do you love that somebody commits zina with your daughter? قال لا والله يا رسول الله جعلني الله فداءك. He said, no, I swear by Allah, Messenger of Allah, may Allah make me your ransom. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, ولا الناس يحبونه لبناتهم. Nor do the people like this or love this for their daughters. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أفتحبه لأختك. Do you love that somebody commits zina with your sister? The youth, he said, لا والله جعلني الله فداءك. He said, no, I swear by Allah, may Allah make me your ransom. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ولا الناس يحبونه لأخواتهم. And nor do the people like this for or love this for their sisters. he said to the youth, أَفَتُحِبُّهُ لِأَمَّتِكُ, do you love this for your paternal aunt? The child or the youth, he said, لَا وَاللَّهِ جَعَلَنِي اللَّهُ فِي دَعَكْ, no, but Allah, may Allah make me a ransom. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَلَا النَّاسُ يُحِبُّونَهُ لِأَمَّتِهِمْ, nor do the people love this for their aunts. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, أَفَتُحِبُّهُ لِخَالَتِكُ, do you love this for your maternal aunt? قَالَ لَا وَاللَّهِ جَعَلَنِيَ اللَّهُ فِدَاءَكُ, no, but Allah, may Allah Azzawajal make me your ransom. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَلَا النَّاسُ يُحِبُّونَهُ لِخَالَتِهِمْ, nor do the people love this for their aunts, their maternal aunts. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his hand upon the youth and said, اللَّهُمَّ اغْفِرْ ذَنْبَ وَطَهِّرْ قَلْبَ وَحَسِّنْ فَرْجَ, he said, O Allah, forgive him his sin, purify his heart, and protect his privates. And it is mentioned that after that, that youth, he didn't look at or turn towards anything. So here, in this narration, barakallahu fikum jami'an, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressed this youth, showing him the evils of zina by asking him, does he like that people commit zina with the women folk of his family? So let the brother who thinks about committing zina or who is committing zina, let him fear Allah Azza wa Jal first and foremost, and let him be mindful that that's somebody's mother or that's somebody's aunt or sister. And just as he doesn't want no one to commit zina with his mother or his aunt or his sister or his daughter, then let him not do it with anybody else's mother or anybody else's aunt and sisters and daughters and the likes. From that which establishes how evil zina is that the punishment for fornication is 100 lashes and being banished from the land for a year. And the punishment for adultery is being stoned to death. And this in itself, barakallahu fikum, is the punishment that Allah Azza wa Jal has prescribed as a means of a deterrent so that the people leave off this despicable act and behavior. But as was mentioned, a zina, it causes harm to the individual, it also causes harm to the families, harm to the communities, harm to the society as a whole. So Allah Azza wa Jal prescribed these punishments as a means of a protection, as a deterrent, and then a protection for the individual, for the families, for the communities, for the societies. Likewise, homosexuality is a major crime and sin, and evil and indecency. Another matter which causes harm to the individual, harm to the families, harm to the community and the societies. As has come in the studies, that the majority of the HIV/AIDS cases has come as a result of homosexuality. And there are other reasons, but the majority is through homosexual practices. And this is the nature of zina, the nature of indulging in illegal sexual intercourse, not preserving one's private parts, that it causes diseases to come down upon the people, that which was not known to the forefathers. And this is one of the things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned from the harms and the evils of zina. Lut alayhi salam, he reprimanded his people for this behavior. And you have Muslims in these days and times, or those who, I should say, ascribe themselves to Islam, saying that homosexuality and lesbianism is permissible. Allah mentions that Lut said that تَأْتُونَ الْفَاحِشَ مَا سَبَقَكُمْ بِهَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ إِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ الرِّجَالَ شَهْوَةً مِنْ دُونِ النِّسَاءِ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ. Are you indulging in indecency that no one before you has preceded you in the whole world, in the history of mankind, no one has done this act? Indeed, you go to men with desires and not women. Rather, you are people who have gone beyond the boundaries. Some of the ulama, they have mentioned that the cause of these men indulging in homosexual behavior was due to them having relations with their wives by way of the anus. And this is mentioned in some of the works of the scholars, that they started by way of having relations with their wives through the anus, and then it led them to indulging in homosexual acts with men. And then when this took place, that the men started to be with the men and abandoned the woman, then the woman started to be with one another, and here you have the lesbianism. In any event, Lut alayhi salam described it as being fahisha, indecency. And it is not like the people have mentioned, no, these individuals were being reprimanded because they were raping one another. This is foolishness. Rather, these men were willingly having relations with one another. And this was not a situation of rape. Homosexuality is forbidden in al-Islam. Lesbianism is forbidden in al-Islam. Go back to the verse where Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, after describing the successful believers, those who preserve their private parts, except from their spouses or that which their right hand possession. So whoever desires other than that, then those are the ones who are the transgression. There is a narration that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ وَجَدْتُمُوهُ يَعْمَلَ أَمَلَ قَوْمِ لُوتْ فَقْتُلُوا الْفَاعِلْ وَالْمَفْعُولِ بِهِ. There's a narration that has been declared authentic by some of the mashayikh, that whoever you find performing the actions of the people of Lut, then execute the doer and the one who is being done to, meaning the authority.
are to apply capital punishment to those who perform these homosexual activities, whether it is the doer or the one who it is being done to. Some of the scholars, they hold that homosexuality is similar to zina. If the person has been married before, then the person is to be stoned, and if not, then the person is to be lashed 100 lashes and then expelled from the land for a year. But look at the punishment that Allah Azza wa Jal gave to the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. As Allah mentions, فَلَمَّا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا جَعَلْنَا عَلِيَهَا سَافِلَهَا وَأَمْطَرْنَا عَلَيْهَا حِجَارَةً. Therefore, when the command, or when our command came, we made the highest part of the town to be the lowest part, and then we showered upon them stones. And it is mentioned that Jibreel alayhi salam, he took the town and went up into the heavens and then slammed it down. And then the stones came down upon the people. And likewise, barakallahu feekum, lesbianism, this is an evil act, even though it is not on the same level of homosexuality, it is evil. For it's not allowed in Islam for a woman to be with a woman. And having a relationship with a woman like a man would have with a woman. This is from the ways of the disbelievers, not from the characteristics of the believers. And our woman, barakallahu feekum, should keep away from this type of behavior. To keep away from that which leads to this type of behavior. And if there are women in the community who are known for this type of behavior, then this is something that should be known to the woman so that the woman can be aware and keep away from these women and warn against these women. For the protection of oneself, one's religion, one's family, the protection of the community, the protection of the society. For this type of behavior breaks up families and homes. A woman is married, but yet she has a woman on the side or something of that nature. And then the husband, he finds out. Evil comes as a result of this. Just like the act of zina breaks up homes. In any event, a separate lecture can be done regarding this topic, going into more details. From the praiseworthy characteristics of the believers, those who keep their covenants and their trust. As Allah mentions, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَأَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ. Those who fulfill their trust in their covenants. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He commands us to fulfill our trust in our covenants. First and foremost, our trust with Allah. Our trust with His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentions, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. Indeed, Allah, He commands you to fulfill or to give the people their trust and their rights, to fulfill them. Allah Azzam, he says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la takhunu Allah wa rasul, wa takhunu amanatikum wa antum ta'lamun. All you who believe, do not betray Allah and the Messenger, nor betray your trust while you know better. The fulfillment of the trust, ikhwan, or akhawat, is from the built of the characteristics of the believers. As for khiyana, khiyana is from the characteristics of the munafiqeen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned ayatul munafiq salah, idha haddatha kazib, وإذا وعد أخلفه وإذا تمن خان. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said the sign of the hypocrite is three. When he speaks, he lies. When he makes the promise, he breaks the promise. And when he is entrusted, he proves to be treacherous. He betrays the trust. Our relationship with Allah and practicing Islam is in a manner. Our duties and responsibilities towards the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in a manner. Our duties and responsibilities in relation to how we deal with other Muslims is in a manner. And it is upon us to fulfill these trusts. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, awfu bil uqood. All you who believe, fulfill the covenants. Fulfill them. This is a commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see this in the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ad-deen al-nasiha, that the deen is nasiha, it is sincerity. Liman ya Rasulullah, for whom, O Messenger of Allah, qala lillahi, wa li kitabihi, wa li rasulihi, wa li a'immat al-muslimin wa ammatihim. Our sincerity is for Allah, for His book, for His messenger, for the leaders of the Muslims, and their common folk. We have to be sincere, fulfill our covenant with Allah, with His book, His messenger, the leaders of the Muslims, the scholars and the rulers, and with the common folk from amongst the Muslims, our brothers and sisters. Fulfill the trust. Do not be deceitful. Do not be one who is a betrayer. From the signs of the last days is that the amanah will be lost. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, إِذَا بُلِعَتِ الْأَمَانَ فَانْتَظِرِ السَّاعَ فَانْتَظِرِ السَّاعَ وَكَمَا قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he stated that when the trust is lost, then wait for the hour to be established. One of the greatest trusts that we have after that which is connected to the rights of Allah, His Messenger, is the trust
that we have with one another as Muslims. Especially husbands and wives. Parents and children. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. All of you are shepherds. And all of you are responsible for one flock. The Prophet went on to mention, وَالرَّجِلُ رَعَى فِي أَهْلِهِ وَهُوَ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ. That the man is a shepherd in his family. And he is responsible for his flock. وَالْمَرْأَةُ رَعِيَ فِي بَيْتِ زَوْجِهَا وَفِي أَوْلَادِهِ وَهِيَ مَسْؤُولَةٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهَا. And the woman is a female shepherdess in the house of her husband, and she is in regarding his children, and she is responsible for her flock. Be mindful of being negligent, brothers and sisters, to one another. Be mindful of husbands and wives of being negligent to one another. Be mindful of parents not to be negligent regarding your children. For indeed, all of us will be held account for our marriages. We'll be held to account for the children that Allah Azza wa Jal has favored us with. These are trust. These are trust. Because Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّهُ لَائِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. Indeed, the hearing and the sight and the heart, all of this a person will be held accountable for. We'll be held accountable how we behave regarding the trust. And this in itself should be an encouragement for us to do good and to fulfill the trust. For Allah Azza wa Jal has praised the believers who fulfill their trust, describing them as being those who will inherit the earth, or excuse me, inherit the paradise. As Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ. Those are the ones who are the inheritors. الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Those who will inherit the firdaus, and they will be abiding therein. Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentions, أُولَٰئِكَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ مُقْرَمُونَ. Meaning those who fulfill their trust, they're going to be in the gardens, honored and raised. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned and showing the importance of keeping the trust and not breaking the trust, and the importance of being a person who's not a betrayer. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أدِّ الأمانة إلى من ائتمنك. أدِّ الأمانة إلى من ائتمنك ولا تخن من خانك. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, fulfill the trust with those who have trusted you or entrusted you with the matter, and do not deceive the one who has deceived you. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Fulfill the trust with those who have entrusted you, and do not deceive or betray the one who has deceived or betrayed you. Even though you have been betrayed, it doesn't give you the right to now go and betray someone. Even though you have been deceived, it doesn't give you the right to go and deceive. because we have to keep the trust that we have been entrusted with. Even if the people do not keep the trust with us. I'll mention one more characteristic for the many Allah people, characteristics of the believers that are from the praiseworthy characteristics. This one is keeping away from vain speech. As Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentions in Surah Al-Mu'mineen, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. Those who turn away from vain speech. Vain speech, Ikhwan wa Akhawat, it is Quran or speech that has no benefit. Speech that does not get a person closer to Allah as a jinn. Speech that does not bring about worldly benefits. From the characteristics, or the praiseworthy characteristics of the believers, is that they stay away from vain speech. For when a person indulges in vain speech, this is the wasting of time. Sheikh al-Islam, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned, ضِيَارُ وَقَشَدُ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ. The wasting of time is more severe than death. لأن الموت يقطعك عن الدنيا وضياع الوقت يقطعك عن الله. He said that is because death only cuts you off from the life of this world, whereas the wasting of time cuts you off from Allah. So, indulging in vain speech, it is one of those things that cuts a person off from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is definitely a characteristic that we want to keep away from. Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said about this verse, that's in Surah Al-Mu'minun, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَى اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. He said, عَلَى الْبَاطِلِ وَيَسْمَعُ الشِّرْكِ كَمَا قَالَهُ بَعْضُهُمْ وَالْمَعَاصِي كَمَا قَالَهُ آخَرُونَ وَمَا لَا فَائِدَةَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْأَقْوَالِ وَالْأَفْعَالِ. And those who keep away from vain speech, meaning they keep away from falsehood. And it includes a shirk, as some of them have mentioned. And it includes al-ma'asi, acts of disobedience, as others have mentioned. وَلَا فَعْلَةَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْأَقْوَالِ وَالْأَفْعَالِ. And that which has no benefit in it from the statements and the actions. Allah Azza wa Jalla praised the believers, describing them as the worshippers of Ar-Rahman from their characteristics. وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. And when they pass by vain speech, they pass by in a noble and honorable manner. When they pass by the vain speech, they pass by in a noble, honorable manner. They don't indulge in it. Meaning that
when they hear from their people evil or cursing or verbal abuse, they turn away from them. And they don't even respond to them. And this is how we should be about Allah feel. But if we find that a person has cursed us, we shouldn't curse them back. Find that a person is being verbally abusive, we should not be verbally abusive. Or from another understanding that has been mentioned, when they pass by, acts of disobedience, meaning when the people are indulging in disobedience and they see them, that they pass by their gatherings quickly, turning away from them. Not indulging or stopping, showing that it is not befitting for the believers to have friendships and gather with the people of disobedience and sin. That's indulging in Allah. Rather, we should make sure that our companionship is the best of companionship amongst the Muslims. And that we should not have companionship with those whose behavior is that which is unbefitting according to the religion of Allah. Because these individuals who are committing crimes, indulging in evil and indecency, speaking with falsehood, and other than that, they have an effect upon one another. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, Al-Mar'u ala deeni khalilihi, falyamnu ahadukum man yukhalif. The person is upon the religion of his friend, so that each one of you look at who he befriends. So when you see the gatherings of falsehood, the gatherings of evil, the gatherings of sin, keep walking. Do not turn to them. Turn away from them. Do not indulge to that which you have no business indulging in. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, من حسن الإسلام من حسني إسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه. From the goodness of a person's Islam is that he leaves off that which doesn't concern him. And that which doesn't concern us as Muslims, that which doesn't concern us as believers, is that which Allah Azza wa Jalla has been prohibited. We should have no dealings with the haram. No dealings with that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited in his book, or that which has been prohibited upon the tongue of his messenger and the authentic sunnah. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll stop at this point. And my apologies for being long-winded regarding this topic. And whatever is correct, the praise is for Allah Azza wa Jalla alone. And whatever is incorrect, it is for myself. Wa subhanaka Allahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khair.